Have you been told that you have familial hypercholesterolemia and must start statin therapy? Well, this is a serious genetic condition, and you owe it to yourself to understand your diagnosis and to know if it's accurate. It's one thing if you've been through a thorough examination and diagnosis. It's another if your doctor's just thrown it at you because your parent had high cholesterol and you do too. That's the subject of today's video. Stay tuned. First, let's get our definitions out of the way. Familial hypercholesterolemia, which I'm just going to call FH for the rest of this video, is a serious genetic condition that results in extremely high cholesterol levels. We're not talking 200 or 300 milligrams per deciliter or 5 to 8 millimoles per liter. We're talking two or three times that. Statistically, HF is a serious heart health risk. You just can't deny that. First, there's heterozygous FH, meaning that the gene for it is inherited from one of the parents, but not the other. And there's homozygous FH, which means the gene for it is inherited from both parents. So let's go back to our thumbnail family and take a look at how this works. Now, this is going to be a simplified look because there's actually more than one gene pair that's involved with it, but we're just going to go with one gene pair for this. We're going to assume that we have a rare situation where both parents have heterozygous FH. In this illustration, the capital F is going to represent the FH gene, and the lowercase n is just going to be the normal gene. On average, about half the children of such a couple are going to be also heterozygous FH. In other words, they inherit an F gene from one parent and an N gene from the other. About a quarter of the children will have homozygous FH, meaning that they get the FH gene from each of their parents, and about a quarter of them will have neither. They get the normal gene from both parents. So those are the lucky kids. So now let's look at my medical history. My record says that I have pure hypercholesterolemia, which I'll call PH from now on. The doctor was actually very specific in telling me that I had FH. You notice I also had a diagnosis of shortness of breath. That was caused by statins, but that's another story. I also have impaired fasting glucose. Doctor never talked to me about this. It's probably my fault because I wasn't an informed and active patient at the time. I am now, and to me, that was actually the most serious condition that I had on this particular visit. What is PH? A lot of the sources I consulted equated PH with FH directly. The Cleveland Clinic, for example, has this on their website. They equate FH with PH by saying they're both caused by genetics. Went to another website, verywellhealth.com, and they seem to imply a similar equivalence between PH and FH. The statement PH or FH is a common genetic disorder associated with high cholesterol. I went to the CDC and the Mayo Clinic websites, and they really don't make that clear of a comparison. The Mayo Clinic site doesn't even use the term pure. The CDC's wording is ambiguous. It's one of those situations where if you read it thinking they're the same, you can interpret it that way. If you read it with the notion that they're different, you can read it that way. It's the ambiguity in this context of that little word or in English. Is the phrase pure or familial hypercholesterolemia meant to say they're different terms for the same thing, or are they terms for two different things? It's actually really not clear on those websites. So sometimes you just follow the money trail. So I looked at the standard billing codes that you'd use with an insurance company, but that added to the confusion. There's a catch-all unbillable code, E78.0 for PH, which has two billable subcodes. E78.00 is PH unspecified, and E78.01 is FH. So the money trail actually indicates that they're different, that FH is a subset of PH and PH unspecified is the other subset of PH. But from all the various different websites, I get the impression that at the very least, FH is the majority subset of PH in general. So we may as well just call them the same thing. So when I was told that I have FH, I probably heard right, and it just went into the record as PH because that's the upper level diagnostic code. First of all, I want to be very clear. I'm not suggesting that anyone should self-diagnose whether or not they have FH. I want to really just provide you with enough information to be able to ask intelligent, clarifying questions if you're told that you have FH or even PH. FH is currently estimated to occur in about somewhere between 1 in 220 and 1 in 500 people worldwide. I'm just going to pick a number like 1 in 300 because it's easier to work with math-wise and for discussion purposes, and it does fall in this range. It's interesting because they say it's a common condition, about 1 in 300 people have it. When it comes to adverse effects of statins, if 1 in 300 people had it, they call that an uncommon adverse effect. Why is it 1 in 300 common in one circumstance and 1 in 300 is uncommon in another circumstance? Just food for thought. There's a 1 in 90,000 chance that a child will have both parents with heterozygous FH. And that means about a 1 in about 360,000 people will actually have homozygous FH, which is maybe 1,000 people in the entire United States. So that I would call a rare condition. And unfortunately, a lot of homozygous FH children die very young, or if they do live, they decide not to have children of their own because they understand their genetic situation. If you're homozygous FH, the best you can hope for is that your child be only heterozygous FH. You could take a genetic test, but the genetic tests aren't perfect, and there's a 60 to 80% chance that it'll actually catch it. In other words, there's a 20 to 40% chance that you'll get a false negative. And these tests can cost hundreds of dollars, maybe into thousands of dollars. With such a high chance of a false negative, it's generally not cost effective to really go down that road right away. There are cheaper alternatives that can at least provide enough context for discussions with your doctor. Clinical diagnosis looks at indicators, just like a lot of what we discuss on this channel. There's online calculators for this, and I put the links for some of these in the description. So here's some examples, and I'm just going to read these. MedPED, which stands for Make Early Diagnosis to Prevent Early Deaths. That's a standard for assessing. We'll call it assessing as opposed to diagnosing FH. There's a Simon Broom criteria, which I assume was named after the developers. There's the Dutch Diagnostic Criteria. It's put out by the Dutch Lipid Clinic Network. And I'm actually going to go into that one in a little more depth. I'm going to use that for example purposes here. And then the National Lipid Association does provide some guidance. The Dutch Diagnostic Criteria, or the DDC, it's a point system based on family history, personal history, a clinical examination, and your LDL level. For family history, it considers first-degree relatives, that is, parents, full siblings, and children. And some of the other criteria look at second-degree relatives. Second-degree relatives are your grandparents, grandchildren, half-siblings, double cousins, and biological aunts, uncles, nieces, and nephews. And in case you're wondering, an ordinary first cousin is actually a third-degree relative for purposes of these assessments. So let's look at that criteria. Under family history, they look at your first-degree relatives and look for premature cardiovascular disease, or LDL in the 95th percentile. In other words, their LDL is so high that 95% of the general population has a lower value. Tendon xanthoma is accumulation of cholesterol on the tendons. Arcus cornealis is the same tendency around the eyes. And again, looking for things like high LDL in a child. Your personal history, do you have coronary artery disease? Premature. That's men under 55 or women under 60. And do you have premature cerebral or peripheral vascular disease? Those are like coronary artery disease, but in other parts of the body. And then a clinical examination, do you have those two conditions that I mentioned earlier? Corneal arcus one is a problem if it's less than 45 years old. And then you get a sliding scale for low density lipoprotein levels. Finally, if you did get the genetic test and you do test positive for the LDL receptor mutation, then you get a certain number of points for that. Finally, you add up all the points and you get an estimate, an assessment. Do you probably have it? Do you definitely have it? Do you, probably don't have it? I just call it an assessment, but it's something you can discuss with your doctor. Can you fix FH on your own through lifestyle? I suppose it depends on who you ask and what you mean by fix. Here's an article, and I'm just going to read this. In an article titled Nine Things You Need to Know About Inherited High Cholesterol, there's this phrase, while a healthy lifestyle cannot fix FH alone, it is still strongly encouraged. Well, yeah, we should all live healthy lifestyles regardless of whether we have FH or not. I have a few reservations about this particular article. There will be a link to it in the description. It claims to have been medically reviewed, but it has what I know to be inaccurate statements in it. For example, it says this, statin medications are another layer of treatment for FH. Okay, that part's good. These include PCSK9 inhibitors, ezetimibe, and bile acid sequestrants. Well, that's inaccurate in the sense that those are not statins. In the way this is worded, that would imply that it's statin. So this makes me wonder how thorough the medical review was on this. Maybe there was a post-review editing error, a sentence was left out or something like that. The Mayo Clinic had this statement. Most people with FH will need to take more than one medication to control their LDL cholesterol levels. That's not explicitly saying that you can't fix it on your own with lifestyle, diet, and exercise, but if most people have to use two or more medications, well, that kind of implies maybe the rest have to use at least one. So I think that's where we stand. What are the treatments besides lifestyle? This is one of the few times you'll ever hear me say this on this channel. This may be that situation where statins, if they're tolerable, may be what you need to take. My position has always been that statins are way overprescribed. You know, give it to everybody over 40 in the water supply, all that nonsense. They should be reserved for very extreme cases, and this could be one of those very extreme cases. Other treatments or other cholesterol-lowering agents that I've spoken about before, this microsomal triglyceride transfer protein inhibitor, that's a new one on me. I've never seen that before. I'm going to have to look into it. I did a brief read up on it, and the only thing that I recall from that is that it can lead to a lot of gastrointestinal problems. Finally, there's LDL apheresis. And I have a friend who's heterozygous FH, and he's statin intolerant. He undergoes LDL apheresis periodically, and he'll be starting bempedoic acid pretty soon. And I'm looking forward to finding out, hoping that actually helps him. Now, this LDL apheresis, it's kind of analogous, I would say, to maybe kidney dialysis. I mean, you actually sit there, blood gets drawn from you, it gets filtered through some sort of machine that pulls the LDL out, and your blood gets returned to you. So it just cycles through, probably takes a couple hours at the very least. Probably feels like giving blood, but basically you send your blood out for dry cleaning and it comes back and your blood's good. And obviously it doesn't take it all out and return it all because you die in between, but takes out a little at a time and returns it at the same rate that it's taking it out. So the question of interest to me is, do I really have FH? You know, I can't diagnose myself, of course, but I have enough of an understanding from the DDC and my results of extreme exercise to equip myself with information to have a meaningful discussion with my doctor. So the next question comes up, which LDL panel should I use? Here's three panels that I've been taking recently. The one that's labeled best, if you saw my video on my 500-mile hike, this was the one where I had the lowest triglyceride to HDL level. So that's one panel we could actually use. The next panel is the one that was 3 days after I returned. I got a full lab workup, not just a finger prick test. And those are the values. And then after being a month off the trail, I'm not doing this extreme exercise. I'm not hiking 10 hours a day. I'm just doing my ordinary 4 or 5 hours of cardiovascular exercise per week plus some other exercises. And that's the panel I got. My body seems to want to return me to about the mid-200s for total cholesterol. In this table, the first figure in each of the boxes is the milligrams per deciliter. The value in brackets is the millimoles per liter, so everybody can understand what they're looking at. And the value underneath that in parentheses is the percentage of people in the general population who have a lower value than the ones given here. So you can see for a lot of them, I had very low values. The exception is my LDL on that third panel. It did go back up quite a bit. The red rows are those where the conventional medical wisdom would be the lower values are better. And the green row, which is the HDL, is where the conventional wisdom that the higher, at least to a certain point, would be better. And like I've said before, triglycerides are very volatile and they really depend on your most recent activities. And they can vary dramatically over short periods of time. So next, let's look at my Dutch diagnostic criteria scores for these panels. And they all put me in the unlikely category. Even the one that would be considered elevated LDL, I only scored a point. I don't have any of those other conditions of the accumulated cholesterol in my corneas or on my tendons. My LDL, while elevated, is not into the extreme levels that are consistent with FH. I haven't had the genetic test, so yeah, there's 8 points that I couldn't score there. But in general, my scores are very low. And then finally, I put all these values in the 2018 pooled cohort equation risk calculator that I've talked about before. Put, of course, my gender, race, systolic BP, diabetes status, and my smoking status. And here are the risks that it came up with. And as you can see, they're very low. So I have low DDC scores, low calculated risk, lipid values that even a statin-pushing doctor would say are healthy numbers, at least for the full lab panel, maybe not that final one. And like I said before, I achieve these numbers through exercise alone. So my 10-year risk values fall below that magically ridiculously low 7.5% threshold to make you eligible for statin therapy. I would have this serious discussion with the doctor, and I suspect that unless the doctor comes up with something that they haven't told me, something that I don't know about, that I don't want to call it a win the argument, but I think we would come away with an agreement at the most to disagree, but probably the doctor would have to admit that I don't seem to have FH. So here's a multiple choice test, and I'm just going to read it. Why might my doctor have told me I have FH and entered it as PH in my record? Well, A, the doctor meant pure rather than familial during the discussion. In other words, an innocent mistake. You know, doctors are in a hurry and they can mix up terms. It was B, the FH discussion was really intended to be preliminary or a warning, but not really diagnostic. C, did I misunderstand or did I not hear correctly? After all, this is a conversation that was 7+ years ago. I may have been misremembering it, as I like to say. So that's a possibility. Or D, was it to persuade me to take a statin? So the cynics among us would probably pick D, though in fact, a doctor who seemed to hint that I might have FH is not the one who actually browbeat me into going on statins. I actually fired that doctor. I don't go to either of these doctors anymore, so I can't initiate that discussion with that doctor. It's almost like they refuse to answer questions if you're not in the office in front of them in a billable situation. I've relocated and I have a different PCP now. Tell me in the comments whether you think it was A, B, C, or D. So what's the point of all this? Well, first, you should take an FH diagnosis seriously. You have to get a correct answer on this. Be informed so that you can have an intelligent and intelligible conversation about it with your doctor. And most importantly, FH is not simply a diagnosis that high cholesterol runs in your family. That's maybe how we see it in casual conversation, but true FH is a specific genetic condition and not just a family tendency. So if my new PCP throws FH my way, at least I know enough about it to discuss it with her, politely, of course. Using those DDC scores and the fact that with sufficient exercise, I can get the numbers down to meet even her LDL goals. So that's what I hope for you. I hope this gives you the information you need if your doctor hits you with the dreaded FH diagnosis. So that's all I have on familial hypercholesterolemia. If you appreciate this information and found it useful, please like, share, comment, subscribe, hit the notification bell. And if you haven't seen this video, take a look at it now. Thanks for listening.